common sacred place. Common because we are all welcome. Sacred because here we transform the ordinary and attend to the profound. Thank you for being with us. On this Sunday, as we look closely at two major movements and celebrate Father's Day, may you experience the mission of Unitarian Universalism to grow in love, faith, justice, and joy. I am Bob Alto, your worship associate for this service. As the writer once stated, may you live with us in the present and make it so beautiful that it will be worth remembering. Despite staying at home and listening on personal devices, know that you are special as you join us today. Know you will find peaceful acceptance here, regardless of racial or gender identity, age, socioeconomic status, sexual orientation, or immigration status. If you're a first timer, new to the congregation, the fellowship, contact our office or the website to download newcomer form. Sign up for our newsletter so you can know the activities and goings on of UUFNN. During our service, you can use the speaker gallery view at the top of your screen and go there or view the service. You can make comments in the chat box, especially in regards to joys and concerns. And now, Reverend Karen.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, and a happy Father's Day to all of our fathers who are out there joining us. I am Reverend Karen Foster, and it is a special delight to welcome you to our service this morning. At the end of our service, you'll be invited to stay on for coffee hour, where you'll be divided into small groups for conversation. Let's join together in our opening song by Emma's Revolution, Swimming to the Other Side.
I am impatient to receive a sign. I move forward.
in these days of heartbreak and turmoil and confusion, in these days of breaking open and new birth, in this time of Juneteenth and Black Lives Matter and Father's Day and Pride, we open our hearts and our minds and our spirits to being connected wherever we are. Let's take a few deep breaths and settle in for a short while so that we can be in community and continue to move from comfort to courage. You're invited to light the chalice that you may have with you at this time, if you have one at your home. And I'll read our chalice lighting words from Joseph M. Cherry. If we have any hope of transforming the world and changing ourselves, we must be bold enough to step into our discomfort, brave enough to be clumsy there, loving enough to forgive ourselves and others. May we, as a people of faith, be granted the strength to be so bold and so brave and so loving.
These times we are living through right now are affecting everyone. We, as the side of love warriors in our gold shirts, are stepping up in so many ways to help bend the arc of moral justice. All of our seven principles call us to do just that. But we need to sometimes step back from our enthusiasm and make sure that as the dominant culture, we are not just running headfirst into saving the world, and in the end, leaving a lot of the most marginalized behind us. So much of our work intersects, and we really need to stop at these intersections, just like we do on the road, and make sure that it's safe to proceed and we're not running anybody over. As a concrete example, I'd like to look at the intersectionality of the women's marches. One of the main purposes of these marches was to show the world women are an equal, and some may even say stronger power than the men running things. And women are so much more than just parts to grab. As we know, marginalized groups have a history of taking an offensive slur, reclaiming it, and making it a thing of power. Like the way some of the LGBTQIA plus alphabet people reclaim the often used slur, queer. This reclamation happened as many in the planning of the women's march decided to reclaim the word pussy. They reclaimed it back from the president's vile pussy-grabbing quote. What evolved out of this was a de facto symbol of the marches, the widely knitted and proudly worn pink pussy hat. While this symbol is empowering to many women, it could also be exclusionary and offensive, and not just because of the use of a sometimes vulgar term, pussy. The systemic straight right power structure, which even the women's march is not exempt from, did not even notice or acknowledge the intersectionality of oppression and ran right over the women of color and the trans community in their cult-like adoration of this hat. To explain, I need to be blunt in using that reclaimed term. Not all women have pussies, and not all pussies are pink. Let that simmer for a minute. By claiming and celebrating the pink pussy hat, two of the most vulnerable marginalized groups of women, the women of color and trans women, are excluded and even more marginalized. While a lot of very good, dear white women will say, that was not the intention, or this symbol is too important to let go. And some just say, I feel so empowered, I don't care. This is why our work is so important. We, the Side with Love Warriors, need to be in the forefront. We need to step up with intention and make sure we look always at intersections to make sure that we see and hear, that we acknowledge, that we include, and that we celebrate even the most marginalized of us.
Now is the time in our service when we have the opportunity to share our bounty with each other and our community. Thank you for your generosity. If you'll notice, please text UUFNN to 73256 and follow the instructions sent to you. It's easy. You can send a cash or check to UUFNN at 780 Del Monte Lane, Reno. Either way, thank you for your generosity. It is in these times that we see the real strength of our fellowship. So many of our members have pulled together in some amazing ways, helping one another, certainly helping others, and finding ways to connect and contribute. This month, we begin Share the Plate. And you can include this in your offerings. Our recipient is the fund created by Action, our faith-based organized partner to provide assistance to undocumented neighbors who are receiving no government stimulus provisions. You can designate your contribution on your check or in your giving by text. Thank you to everyone who has stepped forward during these times to make sure our fellowship is financially secure. We are aware that there are some who cannot make their commitment because of the current situation. So I urge those who can please contribute beyond their pledge. Of course, I'm feeling positive that by all of us stepping up, we will be stronger than ever. Thank you for taking care of our beloved community and fellowship. Now let the offering begin. Thank you. Will you please join with me as we dedicate the offering to the work of this fellowship, which is helping more people grow in love, faith, justice, and joy. We dedicate ourselves and these are offerings.
Nor uncertainty that the worst is still days ahead for us.
The possible futures we face never included an absence of suffering.
But the possibilities for how we move through this time are many.
And it is in the choices that we make that glimpses of hope can be found.
Is that we will accept these evils as the best that we can do.
But that is not the only possibility. There is another.
There is another.
There is another.
There is another.
Possibility that love might just prove to be real.
And prove to be resilient.
And stronger in the end than our self-interests and our failings.
Especially the intersectionality between LGBTQ plus pride and Black Lives Matter. While pride celebrations have always been celebrations of people claiming and being proud of their true identity, they have also always been a protest for human rights at its core. It sure feels strange right now to say happy pride. This moment is anything but happy because of the violence that continues on Black and brown bodies in this country. The movement for Black lives and what's become known as pride are certainly not the same movement, and yet they aren't separate movements either. There have always been Black queer people, no matter how much the white LGBTQ plus movement has pushed them to the margins. And so today we bring together and recognize those intersections of Black lives and LGBTQ pride. I want to add a personal note of my own today. You know, for many years, whenever I was in a gathering and the Pledge of Allegiance would be recited, whenever it got to that part about liberty and justice for all, I didn't believe that that applied to me as a gay person in this country. And so I would remain silent at that part. It felt very personal to me each time I chose not to say, and liberty and justice for all. I didn't feel that I had the same freedoms as a straight person. And so it was my own little mini protest and my way of being true to my own reality. The current struggles in our country have to be at least that personal to me as a white person. It's an immense place of privilege to say, why do they have to protest? Why do they have to be disruptive? Why do they have to take a knee? If it is not personal for us, then we have work to do. And we have to move out of our privilege. You know, the definition of privilege is hanging on to our comfort. Maybe we still have a ways to go to get out of our comfort until it feels personal for us. It is such a great joy that this last week, the Supreme Court saw the way clear to ban employment discrimination against LGBTQ folk. Absolutely. That is a huge victory that has been the culmination of decades of fighting for rights. It also gives me great pride that Nevada has been ahead of the curve on this one. Nevada banned discrimination for gay and lesbian people in terms of employment in 1999, and in 2011, the same for transgender folk. But until this week, across the country, more than half of our states could fire someone simply because they were gay or transgender. It's really important to note that for this particular ruling, the Supreme Court used as its basis the landmark 1964 Civil Rights Act, which had gained momentum at that time from the 1963 March on Washington. That March on Washington was principally organized by a man named Bayard Rustin.
Bayard Rustin is just one of the three pioneers, noble warriors that were Black as well as BLBGTQ. Bayard was a writer, artist, actor, and activist during the Harlem Renaissance, and was also an important pivotal leader in the social rights movement from the 40s to the 80s for civil rights, for socialism, nonviolence, and gay rights. In his writing, he explored issues of sexuality and Black identity. His avant-garde story, Smoke, Lilies, and Jade, is thought to be the first explicitly gay story published by a Black writer. Rustin was referred to as being a well-known civil rights lion. These are but a few of his remarkable moments and contributions. He was a part of Martin Luther King's circle and a leader and central organizer of the 1941 March on Washington to end racial discrimination in employment. He went to India to learn about the techniques of nonviolent civil resistance directly from leaders of the Gandhian movement. In friendship, he worked with diverse congregational members to aid tenant farmers who were losing their land. He promoted the unionization of African Americans through the AFL-CIO. During the 1970s and 80s, he served on many humanitarian missions, aiding refugees from communist Vietnam and Cambodia, at his death, Haiti. His focus was on marginalized communities. In the 1980s, he became a public advocate on behalf of gay causes, speaking as an activist and supporter of human rights. Rustin quoted, he said, "My activism did not spring from my being gay, or for that matter, from being Black. Rather, it is rooted fundamentally in my Quaker upbringing and the values that were instilled in me by my grandparents who reared me." He also helped preserve the California property of those Japanese Americans in internment camps. Rustin was also a pioneer in the movement to desegregate interstate bus travel. He was active in the first Freedom Rides. Regarding his sexuality, he mentioned to his grandmother that he preferred to spend time with males than females. Her reply, "I suppose that's what you need to do." During his life, he was arrested, beaten, defamed, and ostracized for being gay. In 1982, marriage between a same-sex couple was inconceivable, and so Rustin legally adopted Walter Nagel, his partner. Looking back at his career, Mr. Rustin, a Quaker, wrote, "The principal factors which influenced my life are nonviolent tactics, 2 constitutional means, 3 democratic procedures, 4 respect for human personality, 5 a belief that all persons are one." President Reagan, on his death, honored his work for civil and human rights. And on August 8, 2013, President Barack Obama presented the Presidential Medal of Freedom to Walter Nagel. Our second LGBTQ warrior is Audre Lorde. She's self-described as Black, lesbian, mother, warrior, poet, who said, "Survival is not an academic skill. It is learning to take our differences and make them strengths." She was raised in New York City by distant and difficult Caribbean immigrant parents. She was so nearsighted, almost to be legally blind. Lorde struggled with communication and found poetry her thought process. At the National University of Mexico, she found her identity as a lesbian and poet. She worked as a professor, librarian, and gay rights leader in New York. She founded organizations to assist women who survived sexual abuse and violence, as for those who were affected by apartheid and other forms of injustice. She also made a huge impact on the Afro-German movement. Books and her writings are lasting legacies. Lorde's emotive poetry angrily confronted and addressed injustices of racism, sexism, classism, heterosexism, and homophobia. Reversal writing is omnipresent in her explorations of anger, loneliness, and what it means to be a Black lesbian woman, mother, friend, and lover. I share an excerpt from her poem, Power. I am trapped on a desert of new gunshot wounds and a dead child dragging his shattered Black face off the edge of my sleep. Blood from his punctured cheeks and shoulders is the only liquid for miles. And my stomach churns at the imagined taste while my mouth splits into dry lips without loyalty or reason, thirsting for the wetness of his blood as it sinks into the whiteness of the desert where I am lost without imagery or magic, trying to make power out of hatred and destruction, trying to heal my dying son with kisses. Only the sun will bleach his bones quicker. Our third LGBTQ Black revolutionary is Laverne Cox. She is quoted as saying, "It is revolutionary for any trans person to choose to be seen invisible in a world that tells us we should not exist." Born to a Black mother in Mobile, Alabama, she attempted suicide at 11 because her feelings for males, and she was bullied for not acting the way someone assigned male at birth was supposed to act. Transform Me made her the first African-American transgender person to produce and star in her own TV show. She has been on the Ebony Power 100 list as well as the OutPower 50 list. She has been on the cover of Time magazine, a first for a trans woman. In Netflix, Orange is the New Black, she highlighted the fact that in her role as the multidimensional Sophia Bursette, the audience is empathizing with a real trans person. With her fame and awards, Laverne Cox has been a trailblazer for the transgender community by opening the discussion about transgender identity, culture, and how it intersects with one's race. In a controversial confrontation on the show Katie, Cox responded about genital reconstruction. "I do feel that there's a preoccupation with that. The preoccupation with transition and surgery objectifies trans people. And then we don't get to really deal with the real lived experiences. The reality of trans people's lives is that so often we are targets of violence. We experience discrimination disproportionately to the rest of the community. Our unemployment rate is twice the national average. If you are a trans person of color, that rate is 4 times the national average. The homicide rate is highest among trans women. If we focus on transition, we don't actually get to talk about those things." In 2018, she received the Claire Skiffington Vanguard Award from the Transgender Law Center. So I hope the things you have heard will motivate you, make you think about these trailblazers, these pioneers. They are Bayard Rustin, Audre Lorde, and Laverne Cox.
Anyone ever tell you you were loved? loving is a miracle. How deeply you're connected to my soul.
This week, as we explore the intersectionality of Black Lives Matter and Pride, we acknowledge that in the past 2 weeks, the Black trans community has lost at least 4 souls to violence. We say their names. Tony Dade, a trans man killed by police in Tallahassee, Florida. Rhea Milton, a trans woman murdered in Liberty Township, Ohio. Dominique Remy Fells, a trans woman murdered in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Selena Reyes Hernandez, a trans woman brutally murdered. Her assailant came back after he left and shot her again. She was in Chicago, Illinois. In the past month, at least 4 men of color have been found hanging in public areas. This is not coincidental. We say their names. Dominique Alexander, Fort Tyron Park, New York. Robert Fuller, Palmdale, California. Malcolm Harsh, Victorville, California. An unnamed 17-year-old Black male in Spring, Texas. Because of his age, they did not print his name.
Loving is a miracle. How deeply you're connected to my soul.
Join our hearts and our minds and our spirits together in our time of prayer and meditation this morning. Spirit of life, mystery, source of love, ground of our being. We acknowledge today, this weekend of Juneteenth, when 2 years after the Emancipation Proclamation, the last slaves were finally freed from bondage. We give thanks today for all of those fathers among us who have nurtured and sacrificed and provided and given of themselves. We give thanks today that the Supreme Court also saw fit today, this week, to preserve DACA, the Dreamers Act. We give thanks today for Matilda, Louisa, Jane, Adams, Famula, born to Kristen and Jason on Thursday evening. And we give thanks that all three are doing very well. We have much to be thankful for in these days, and we have much to grieve. And so you're invited at this time to place in the chat box your thanksgivings and celebrations, your concerns, your fears, and your sadnesses. We gather together all of our joys and our concerns, our celebrations, our worries, our fears, and we gather them as one into the very heart of love. Blessed be, and amen.
How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful?
Thank you so much for joining us for our service today. It's been a delight to be together. Just a reminder to watch your emails for programming that happens throughout the week so that you can join us for all of our connection opportunities. If you need help with Zoom or any other support, please let us know and we'll be happy to connect you with someone who can help. And if you're new to us, please do fill out the online newcomer card, which is in the chat box, so that we can keep in touch with you. Also, please do share our worship link with folks who need a time like this to be together. I wanted to let you know that those dear friends of our congregation, Emma's Revolution, are going to be with us live and in person on Zoom for a very special worship service. A couple of other congregations will join us for that on July 19th. So be sure and be here for that very special worship with Emma's Revolution on July 19th. Next Sunday is going to be our General Assembly worship, and we'll be joining for that at 10 o'clock. So please watch your emails for that link so that you can join the UUA General Assembly worship. It's always an extraordinary event, so you'll not want to miss that time together next Sunday at 10 o'clock, a little bit earlier. The Poor People's Campaign Revival has been going on this weekend, and that will be shown again this afternoon at 3 o'clock Pacific time at june2020.org, and that link is in our emails from over this weekend as well. Just a note about our posse. Our posse who feeds hungry neighbors is continuing to do that even in these times, utilizing all of the safety precautions. And what they are asking us to collect now are water bottles. Not disposable full water bottles, but water bottles that can be filled again and again so that folks can keep them. And you're invited to bring those and place them in the bins between the buildings here at UUFNN, and those will be distributed. If you're out in the congregation today and you're a father, in any way that you define that, would you just raise your hand so that we can give you a thanks? I invite you to place a hand on your heart and sending of love with the other hand, and we thank all of our fathers today who are with us, and we wish you the happiest of Father's Days. The only way that we can keep going in these days is to keep on moving forward. So would you join us for a closing song by Emma's Revolution?
Gonna keep on moving forward. Keep on moving forward. Keep on moving forward. Never turning back. Never turning back. Sigamos adelante. Siempre adelante. Siempre adelante, sin volver atrás, sin volver atrás. Gonna keep on loving boldly, keep on loving boldly, keep on loving boldly, never turning back. Never turning back. Amaremos con pasión. Siempre con pasión. Siempre con pasión. Sin volver atrás. Sin volver atrás. Gonna reach across our borders, reach across our borders, reach across our borders, never turning back, never turning back. Vivamos sin fronteras. Siempre sin fronteras, siempre sin fronteras, sin volver atrás, sin volver atrás. And sow the seeds of justice, sow the seeds of justice. Sow the seeds of justice. sembremos la justicia. Siempre la justicia. Siempre la justicia. Sin volver atrás. Sin volver atrás. Gotta keep on moving forward. Keep on moving forward. Keep on moving forward. Never turning back. Never turning back. Never turning back. Never turning back. Never turning back.
You're invited to stay on following our service for coffee hour conversations. Beloved, would you receive the blessing? Know, dear ones, that you are loved beyond belief, and you are a spark of love in our world. It is together that we can break this world wide open, create a new way and a new day, and move from comfort to courage. May it be so. Blessed be, and amen.